intend to colonize Huasca. Moreover, the demand of Thompson and was put to the excesses of the infamous general Andronic, who was expelled from the borders of Caraba. In 20 and 22, the Shusha, Jawanshir, and Jabrail districts of the Ganj governorate at the makeup of the Azerbaijani Caesar. From 1923, the Shusha district and some parts of the Jawanshir and Jabrail districts were transformed into the Nagorno-Karabakh Autonomous Region in the composition of Azerbaijan SSR. Thus, over a period of 1600 years, Karabakh as a whole and its upper section in particular formed part of Azerbaijani state formations or represented of themselves an administrative unit of Azerbaijan provinces. Despite the contention of Armenian authors, they were never ancient Armenian lands unified whether handed over to the Azerbaijan Republic in the 1920s. On the contrary, the incontrovertibility of the historical fact forced the Bolsheviks of the Lenin-Stalin court as well as the parts of the Tsarist Empire even 100 years earlier to leave Karabakh in the makeup of Azerbaijan. Moreover, after the establishment of Transcaucasia of communist power at the Bayonet, the Red Army powerful forces were set in motion. The Caucasian Bureau of the Central Committee of the Russian Communist Party passed a decree of the on the transference of the upper part of Karabakh to Armenian force to Lenin in 1921. However, exactly 24 hours later, this was annulled and the resolution was passed, which was became today's standard reading. Starting from the requirement of national peace between the Muslims and Armenians and of the economic link between Upper and Lower Karabakh and its and of its permanent link with Azerbaijan, Nagorno-Karabakh is remained within the borders of Azerbaijan SSR, also adds to be granted wide autonomy. First abandoned the idea of wrenching Karabakh away from Azerbaijan, the Supreme Red Legate in the Caucasus, Ardonikad, bringing the effect idea of autonomy. It was not out of feelings towards the Armenian, but through the force imperial interests. I well appreciate that in certain political circumstances we may have need of Armenia. He conducted the dialogue whether independent Azerbaijan is necessary exclusively. He conducted the dialogue whether independent Azerbaijan is necessary exclusively. In the language of diktat, it required Azerbaijan to pronounce the autonomy of these regions, but this must emanate from Azerbaijan. Matters took on such a scandalous character that Lenin appointed another underling for Secretary Kirov under whose chairmanship in September 1921, the Central Committee of the Communist Party of Azerbaijan passed the following resolution to ask the Kirov Bureau to re-examine its decision on the division of Nagorno-Karabakh to announce any autonomy pending this. But things didn't work out that way. Baku was able to withstand Ardonikadze's pressure for only one and a half years. In June 1923, the Regional Committee of the Russian Communist Party demanded in the form of an ultimatum that Nagorno-Karabakh be detached into an autonomous region within 1 month and the implementation of the decree of the Azerbaijani Central Committee of the formation of the autonomous region of Nagorno-Karabakh from 7th July 1923. Protagonists for an exhalation italicized the macrophage argument by which Karabakh were characterized as 94% Armenian. Also, Dr. Tessa Hoffman said about propagating argument for annexation when referring to this phase of the Karabakh drama. Famous for her many publications of Armenia, Hoffman published an abusive paper in Tribunal of the People considering the Turkish Republic for a 1915 tragedy which had nothing to do with the Republic. However, the statement on the demographic situation in Karabakh appeared no staggering than the contention cited earlier of Balayan to the fact that Armenian population was predominant throughout the whole of history. The resettlement of 50,000 Armenians from Iran apparently didn't apply to Karabakh. To return to the historical sources, the first special household description of the Karabakh province was carried out by the Russian authorities in 1823, immediately after the abolition of the Khanate. The inquiry fixed the number of the households at 18,963, of which 1559 families or 8.4% fell to the share of the five Armenian Melchites, Talush, Chilabert Varanda Tisagan Hachan. Admittedly, this tells us almost nothing about ethnic composition of Karabakh. The late 1820s marked a watershed for Karabakh. As a result of the Russia-Persian Treaty of Turkmenchay of 1828, many Armenians from Iran, later from Turkey, were resettled in Karabakh and other provinces of Azerbaijan. Clustering of Paskevich instructions provided to settle most of them in the areas of Nakhchivan and Erevan because of the particular desire to ensure the growth of the Christian population here, first planned to send to Karabakh the residents of not only three border villages, but scarcity of land and resources in the first two provinces changed the initial plan. By order of the same, Paskevich of 24th April 1828 and absolute majority of 5,000 Armenian families who had arrived in Rex were settled in Karabakh. Moreover, in this connection with the lack of the state lands in Nakhchivan, many of the settlers designed to these provinces were sent to Karabakh. As a result of the 41.2 Henry 45 Armenians, 8.2 Henry 49 families arrived from Iran in the first 3 to 5 months. Approximately 3,000 settled in Karabakh. The Russian writer Igor Beyadov, author of the idea of resetting Armenians, has left an important testimony of the given questions. Although we argued quite a lot over the suggestions as to what should be done with the Muslims in order to reconcile them to the burden they are currently bearing, which will not be long-lasting, and to eradicate from them their misgivings regarding the Armenians permanently taking control of the land where they were first allowed to go. Gorbayadov has befitted the man who had received appointment to the post of Minister Plenipotentiary of Russia to Tehran had recourse to violent phrases. More infatuated expression of these opinions was the St. Petersburg's author Shafrov, who wrote, "We began our colonizing work not with settling Russian people in Transcaucasia, but with the settlement of others. Then after the end of the war in 1828 and 8 during 1826 and 8 during the 2 years 1828-3, we resettled in Transcaucasia more than 40,000 Persian and 84,000 Turkish Armenians and settled them in the best public lands in the gubernates of the Elizabethpol and Erevan, where the Armenian population was insignificant, and in the Tbilisi Gubernate and the districts of Bartolo, Alkhatiska and Alkhakala. For their settlement, more than 200,000 decisions of public land were set aside, and more than 2 million rubles worth of private land was purchased among the Muslims. The mountains part of the Elizabethpol Gubernate and the shore of the Lagecha were settled with these Armenians. It's essential to bear in mind more than 124,000 Armenians officially resettled were resettled here together with many of the unofficial ones, so that the general number of the resettled significantly exceeds 200,000 persons. Such a state of affairs resulted in the fact that of 1.3 million Armenians resident in Transcaucasia at the start of the century, over 1 million, in accordance with the source cited, don't belong to the number of native dwellers but were settled by us. From this, it's clear that the dividing line of the 1830s was the time when the demographic situation of the area began to undergo a radical shift as a result of Tsarist politics. In full agreement with this, the summary household description of 1832 revealed more than a four-fold increase in the percentage of the Armenian population in the Karabakh province, 34.8% compared to 44.4% in 1823. Naturally, we're not dealing with a case of demographic explosion during these 2 or 3 years. The demographic situation didn't change in Karabakh alone, but everywhere throughout Transcaucasia. Table 6.2 illustrates the percentage balance of Azerbaijanians and Armenians in the 19th century. To take the data on Karabakh for the period of the First World War, then according to the Caucasian calendar published each year by the Chancellery of the Imperial Legate and Tbilisi, the correlation of the two nationalities in 1915 was respectfully expressed by the figures 43.5% to 52.5% and in 1917 as to 40.2% to 52%. 2.3%. And so the passage about the number of Armenians reaching 96-98% in Karabakh, one of the historical regions of Armenia, remains wholly upon the conscience of the authors of similar mystification. The percentage balance of the Karabakh Armenian right up to 1917 never exceeded 3%. The tragedy came later. During the years 1918-28, there was a mass liquidation of Turks by the band of Andranik, Tewandro, and Derik, and practically all regions were the leading joint communities. Sources are by no means anonymous of the extent of the ethnic cleansing that occurred in these years. According to the investigation by one of the Armenian historians, during the 1930s, masses existence of the Armenian Republic, 200,000 Azerbaijanis were liquidated, as a result of which the number was reduced from 260,000 to 60,000 persons. Also in Baku, the Dashnaks from Sari 1st March to 3rd April 1918 massacred 12,000 Turks and more than 20,000 from the towns of Shamakhikuba and Linkara. The second phase of ethnic cleansing at the expense of the Azerbaijanis in Bars, Armenia and Karabakh proceeded under the cloak of communist dictatorship. 1950 Stalin, by a single strike of the pen, sanctioned the deportation from the Armenian SSR of more than 100,000 Azerbaijanis. Covered form of ethnic cleansing began to harmonize with legal ones. Authors emphasized to the argument that Karabakh constitutes one of the historical regions of Armenia denied the fact that this area is one of the historical houses of the Turkic culture of Azerbaijan. Dr. Tessa Hoffman made her own infamous contribution when she wrote categorically, "And the history of Azerbaijan, Karabakh never played a role as a center of culture. The great poet Vagev lived and worked on the land of Karabakh, and its presence enforces the whole of his old output. Karabakh is the homeland of the classics of national culture and science, Khurshid Banu Natavan, Qasım Bey Zakir, Necip Bey Vezirov, Ibrahim Bey Ekberdiev, the brothers of Zeyk Bey, Zulfikar Bey Jabbar, Garyagdoğlu, Sadık Cam, Bülbül, Fikret Emir, Reşit Bey Ekberdiev, Mirzadi Gözel Bey, Mirza Cemal Cavanşır, Ahmet Bey Cavanşır, Mimlesin Nevva, Fritim Bey Kaçer, and others. It's sufficient to say that Adolf Berger, the German rentalist, was famous when Russia published in Leipzig in 1867. And the original is a recollection of poets popular in the Caucasus in Azerbaijan. In this volume, the names of Karabakh poets predominate, which gave the basis of 1903 for Fritim Bey Kaçer to call it a monument of Karabakh poetry. It's corresponded to the state of affairs which Karabakh occupied in the cultural life of Azerbaijan in the second half of the 18th and first half of the 19th century. In the middle of the last century, in the town of Şuşa, the literary unions of Meclis-i Kamusan encompassing Sari writers for active. The great dramatist Mirza Fethullah Gündoğdu lived and was kept in touch and corresponding with their leading members. The town of Şuşa is rightly considered to be historical center of the national musical culture of Azerbaijan. The Armenian musicologist at the start of the century, Garganov, named Şuşa the conservatory of the Transcaucasus. He wrote, "Şuşa, this blessed homeland of poetry, music and song, supplies the Transcaucasus with musicians and singers. It serves as a conservatory of the whole for the whole of Transcaucasia, providing it for every season, indeed month, with new songs and new motifs." It's striking that Uzeyir Bey Jubeli, the founder of the national and in general of the oriental part of Upper Asia, received his first musical lessons in precisely in this town. In this connection, one of the Russian musicologists wrote, "Şuşa has long enjoyed the reputation of the musical genre. It glorifies throughout the whole Caucasus as the inextinguishable home of popular musical talent. The musician of Şuşa made a history of Azerbaijan music and represented it not only at home but also in other oriental countries. Attempts to deny Azerbaijan's connection with Karabakh by manipulating both historical and cultural categories are thus manifest." The same can be said of Nakhchivan. The struggle of the Aini Begratid, the Nakhchivani raid end of the 11th and beginning of the 10th century was the sole attempt to establish Armenian rule here throughout the whole of the Middle Ages. This attempt was suppressed by Yusuf ibn Abu Saj, representative of the Turkic dynasty of the Sajid, which gave, according to the definition of Kremsik, a line of the energetic rulers of the Azerbaijan Emirate. In 1915, he seized Alanish fortress where Sambat was hiding with his exchequer. The latter was secured in the town of Dui. In the state of the Tabaks of Azerbaijan, the town of Nakhchivan was moved into the category of a political center, becoming in effect the second capital of the state along with Tabriz. After the establishment of Russian rule in the Nakhchivan province, the latter was incorporated with the town of Ordubad into the composition of the Armenian region and then in the form of a district within the Erevan governorate. The fact that the Nakhchivan Erevan Khanate had been seized in the course of a single campaign served as motive in the hands of the Caucasian military administration of Russia. However, the Russian government apparently attached no great significance to such facts of splitting land belonging to one owner but land belonging to another, for by the will of the very same governing part of the land of today's Armenia with the towns Dilijan and Ijevan were incorporated right up to 1918 within composition of the Kazakh district of the Elizabethville governorate, the second largest administrative unit of North Azerbaijan. On this basis, the Azerbaijanis present no ways of Dilijan and Ijevan in their talk of Nakhchivan as an ancient region of Armenia doesn't go away. The result of the mass settlement of the real, the divide of the 1820s and 1830s transplanting Armenians could appear the most serious. On the eve of this action, according to Russian source, the native inhabitants, the Muslims, settled here since the 6th and 7th centuries, that's from the time of the dominion of the caliphs, numbered 2,901 households or 86.5% were raised Armenians, an ancient inhabitant, as is indicated thereto, numbered 434 households or 13.5%. So thus transplanted from Persia pushed the number of Armenian households up to 2,719, as a result of which the population balance was almost comparable with that of the Turk, comprising 49.4%. Another source notes pointedly that a great part of Armenian Nakhchivan district settled here from the Azerbaijan province after the conclusion of the Turkmenchai peace with Persia in 1828. However, in proportion to the weakening of the operation of volitional factors, the demographic situation in the area towards the end of the 19th century began to follow a peaceful course. The practice, rightly described by Maitre de Malavile as the transformation of the minority and the majority by means of the liquidation of the Muslim population in this particular case, misfired. With the formation of the independent state of Transcaucasia, an ending struggle went up between Azerbaijan and Armenia over the Nakhchivan and the Shirak districts. The elite powers at one point mounted a project for forming a general governorate under the protectorate of the USA, after which they inclined to a hand over the district to the government of Armenia. The people themselves made a decisive statement in forming their own Iraq Republic. Not without the cooperation of the 11th Red Army of Bolshevik Russia, the Nakhchivan Soviet Republic was formed on 28th June 1920, which proclaimed itself to the part of the Azerbaijan SSR. Soon the 11th Army transposed its experiment to Armenia, and on 1st December 1920, Narimanov, chief of Soviet East Azerbaijan, issued an order for the withdrawal of Azerbaijan forces from Zengezur. A day earlier, Zengezur and the decision of the Politburo and Bureau of the Central Committee of the Communist Party of Azerbaijan, where everything was being directed by Arjunikadze, had been transferred to Armenia, which had only just been Sovietized. The decision had a fatal significance for Nakhchivan and for the whole of Azerbaijan. Its territory, comprising 91.300 km, was reduced to 86.300 quadrat km. The republic, whose sovereignty was granted by treaty with the Russian Soviet Federative Socialist Republic, was dismembered and so skillfully that Nakhchivan found itself in total isolation. One of the problems of the strategy of the Dashnak Party was realized already in the years of the First World War, as a historian humbly writes in one official report addendum presented to the state organs of Russia, the following was said: the many people split Tatar, Transcaucasian Azerbaijan from the Turks of Asia Minor, a wage-driven and the flesh of the Turkic tribes. We cannot permit this wage to disappear, and in its place the appearance of compact mass of Muslims who are hostile to us. The Treaty of 20 March 1921 between Russia and Turkey somewhat smoothed out the bitterness of the loss when it was agreed that the Nakhchivan region was an autonomous territory under the protectorate of Azerbaijan. This said a protectorate would be not allowed to surrender to any Serb state. Turkey, which acquired the border with the Nakhchivan Republic, became the grantor of its autonomous status. And in 13 October 1921, representatives of the five republics concerned, Russia, Turkey, Azerbaijan, Armenia, and Georgia, signed an agreement by which the current existing borders were created. Both agreements are still valid, especially as those governments they signed the first article of the Kars Treaty declared invalidity and invalidity are known, especially as those governments that signed the first article of Kars Treaty declared the invalidity of all preceding agreements between them, with exception of the March Treaty of 1921. The Kars Treaty is considered the charter of diplomatic agreements concerning Eastern and Anatolian Transcaucasia. Under the authority of the Armenian Tsar, in this agreement as the signature of the Commissar of Foreign Affairs Mravyan and the Commissar of Internal Affairs Makinzia. From this it follows that until the Republic of Armenia officially denounces the agreement, all her opening secret acts regarding Karabakh Nakhchivan must be qualified by the United Nations and other world organizations. On 15th July 1987, one of the Dashnak leaders, Papazian, wrote the following in this party newspaper Gum. The Armenians have historical claims. The Armenian nation has a historical land situated on the borders of the Caucasus. Today we have clearly defined territorial claims. The Dashnaks didn't reveal exactly which territory on the Caucasian borders. Here in the USSR, where communist propaganda is presented in the guise of internationalism, the taboo was disturbed in the very same year by the academic Agamben. Mikhail Gorbachev found himself in the Paris en route to the USSR and said the following. I'd like the Karabakh situated in the north of the republic to become Armenian. As an economist, they consider that this region is more linked to Armenia than to Azerbaijan. This was given the go-ahead, albeit under an economic guise. However, the historical camouflage was not forgotten. The account of the publication of the French communists begins with the passage of Karabakh Nakhchivan mentioned Armenian lands next to the Azerbaijan Republic. The president of Armenia has revealed on no more than one occasion that Yerevan doesn't have any territorial pretensions to Azerbaijan. However, the decision of the Armenian SSR in 1989 regarding the uniting of the Nagorno-Karabakh Autonomous Region to Armenia was not annulled. In that year, the Parliament of the Armenian Republic made a decision that rendered the prohibition of participation on other agreements in which the Karabakh was considered to be a part of Azerbaijan. The problem of national minorities in a sovereign state was replaced by the Armenians with an artificial absolutist law on the self-determination of the Karabakhian Armenians and was later treated exclusively the territorial problems. An election is hopeless because a similar approach led Armenia to an unavoidably contradiction with the principle of the inviolability of borders, which is recognized by all European states and the world community. It seems that European and American politicians don't fully acknowledge the fact that the mountains Karabakh is not the outstrips of Azerbaijan in the literal sense. The region is geographically closer to Armenia, but it is not borders with this country. In this sense, the region is the middle territory of Azerbaijan. That is, between Karabakh and Armenia, there lies a stretch of Azerbaijan land equal to the area of half the mountainous part of the Karabakh itself. From this is it follows that the idea of the merging of the Karabakh with Armenia of other modifications will inevitably result in annexing of new Azerbaijani land. It's well known in Armenia that without this, the existence of republics of the mountains Karabakh is impossible. Therefore, those who support Armenians act in the name of the self-determination of the Karabakh are encouraging her to open an action. In this case, it's hardly possible to talk to devotion to the Helsinki process. Now, it's obvious to every unprejudiced person that at the root of the Karabakh conflict lies an attempt by Armenia to defend the interests of Armenians in Azerbaijan by force of arms. With this aim, she unleashed war in the territory of another state. There's a platform for a reduction of this tragic moment of events. This is the unconditional recognition of the inviolability of existing state borders and the securing of constitutional rights for all people and nationalities, and on these grounds a quick ceasefire. There is no alternative political solution of the Karabakh problem. The problem cannot be solved by having troops march onto territory of another state annexing that territory, not only because this violation of international law, but because a protracted war inevitably leads to a dreadful political, economic and moral expenditure for the aggressor.